Well, good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you here to Massey Place Church. Welcome, those, special welcome to those who are joining us online right now on Facebook or YouTube. We're so glad you're able to take time out of your day to join us. And a very warm welcome to those of you who are here in person as we enter into this winter season of 2021. We're just so grateful that you're able to be here and join us as we worship together as the body of Christ gathered here at Massey Place Community Church. I have just a few announcements that I want to begin with today. And like always, if you have any questions about them, please feel free to ask myself or Pastor Karen, and we can give you details. I'll go through them fairly quickly for us, and then we will join together in worship after that. We do want to continue on with our emphasis as a church on our prayer time together. And so following the service today, we will have a prayer time. After the live stream is turned off, we'll stay gathered together here for a time of prayer together as a church. If you are joining us from home and you get our regular church emails, in one of those emails will be a link to that Zoom prayer meeting. And you can click on that link and join us for the prayer time following the service today. If you're not able to do that and you have prayer requests, feel free to text them through to my cell phone, and it's on our church material as well, and it will show up live during the Zoom time as well. So you can text me prayer requests if you can't be here in person. I also want to let you know of three very important upcoming events, three very important things that are happening with the business life of our church. Tomorrow night, I'm doing a membership class, Monday evening, November 22nd, tomorrow, at 7 p.m. here at the church. This membership class is for all those who are interested in declaring that this is their church that they want to support and become part of our family together, a member of this church family. If you're interested in that, even if you're not sure if you want to make that commitment or not, we will talk about all what that means, about who we are as a church, and our vision for the future tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. So you're welcome to come join me tomorrow night. I don't need to know. I'll be here with whoever comes at 7 o'clock. And there will likely be some from our Spanish service that will be joining us as well for that membership evening tomorrow night at 7 p.m. We're doing this in ahead of our annual business meeting, which is happening next Sunday at 6 p.m. We will have a business meeting, and we'll encourage we strongly encourage all of our members to come to that business meeting, where we will present new leadership team members to join our leadership team and new trustees to join our trustee team, as well as our 2022 annual budget will be presented. And those three items will be presented before the membership of the church, where they will get a chance to vote and approve those, all of them presented by the leadership team. And so anyone is welcome to come to the event, that meeting. Members are invited to vote for those items at the meeting next Sunday evening at 6 p.m. here at the church. We're going to do it in the same setup that we have now. There'll be some from our Spanish service here and some from our English service, but we'll be spread out in the hall, and we'll do it this way. It will also be available through Zoom. For those of you that can't make it on Sunday evening, you'll be able to join us at home from Zoom, and you'll still be able to vote through Zoom as well. And if you live in Saskatoon and driving in winter at night is not your favorite thing to do, I do have a number of people who are willing to pick you up at your house before the meeting and drive you home after our leadership team meeting as well. So if you'd like to be here in person but don't want to drive yourself, just let me know and we'll make arrangements for that as well. Also, in that same regard, if you know someone who is interested in joining our leadership team, please talk to them, see if they are willing to talk to me about it, and I can let them know what's involved in becoming a leadership team member or a trustee and what responsibilities there are. We are looking for new people to join that leadership team, and so you can nominate those around you, those that you think would be a good fit for the leadership team, and bring those names to us. There are forms for that available on the front desk, but find me following the service today if you have any questions about that. I also want to let you know that we have a men's breakfast happening the last Saturday of each month, and so this coming Saturday, November 27th, will be the next men's breakfast. It'll be 9 a.m. here at the church. All the men are welcome of all ages to come and join us for men's breakfast next Saturday at 9. We also are entering into the Christmas season, the Advent season, and so I want you to know that on the church email this week, there's going to be a link that will come to you with an Advent devotional that's put together by our denomination, and all of the devotionals in it are written by people from various churches across our denomination. So most from in Canada, a few from our connected churches outside of Canada. There's one from our connected church in Kuwait as well, and a few other places. We are getting paper copies of that. We are told they're being shipped to us. We hope they arrive by next Sunday. But we do have the electronic version for you as well. So you'll get a link to the electronic version. Hopefully we'll have paper copies to put in your hand. And those devotionals, we're going to invite you to do as a church, as a devotional over the Advent season, as all of our families can do that together. And it will also make up the bulk of what we talk about on Sunday mornings for our sermon time as well. We will base it on that Advent series. To bring everything kind of under one banner for that Christmas season, for this Christmas season this year. So I just wanted to let you know about that and let you know that those are a few of the upcoming events. So membership meeting tomorrow night, men's breakfast next Saturday, our annual business meeting next Sunday, and Advent the week after, or that Sunday as well, next week is Advent. I want to invite Karen and the worship team, I think, to come up, and they're going to lead us in our first few songs today.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present time in times of trouble. God is our refuge and strength. God is our refuge. God is. Be still. Be still and know. Be still and know that I am God.
Let's affirm scripture as a prayer over those in our midst, in our city, in our country, and abroad, around the world, who are going through times of trouble and who really need God's strength today. So let's just say this together again. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Now louder. God is our refuge and strength. God is our refuge. God is. Give you a moment of silence to think about that. Mm-hmm.
with us. The God of Jacob is our strength.
Let's pray. Sovereign God, we put the lives of others before us today and intercede on behalf of disaster survivors and their families around the world. And in particular this morning, we ask that you would show your presence in a mighty way to those who have been displaced by the floods of the sea, and that you would give incredible strength and wisdom to those aiding in the recovery efforts. We ask that you would keep them safe. God of refuge, we worship you, the God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow, who was, is, and is to come. Amen. Love. The kids at this time to follow Brett downstairs for the children's lesson. Have a great time.
What an amazing way to begin our worship service today, isn't it? To sing songs like we just sang about Jesus, who rose from death to life and victory, who is alive in us. In essence, this is what the heart of what we've been talking about as we've been journeying through this Masterpiece in Progress series. It's what Paul emphasizes at the beginning as he stresses to the Ephesian church and to us through them the importance of our faith and what it actually means. This week we get to finish off our six-week series, but just as a reminder of where we have been, because it plays such an important role in us understanding this portion of text, and this is an important portion of text and a popular one we're going to look at in Ephesians 6, but it builds off of the previous five chapters and everything that came before it, and I want to recap it just so that we know the foundation of what Paul has laid here so that we can remember. Now, if you were to sit down and read Ephesians, it would take you 20 minutes to half an hour maybe, and you would begin to put these connections together. But over 6 weeks, a little bit each Sunday, sometimes we forget these connections. He began the book, this letter, by reminding people who Jesus is and why we were created. In Ephesians chapter 1, he simply says, "For before the creation of the world, he chose us." And to me, this is one of the most profound statements that I have read in the last few years in Scripture that has impacted me personally, because what this means is that God chose you. He knew that he was going to create one of you before he ever created the world. Now, the significance of that, if you really let it sink in, is that with all of our imperfections and all of our failings, we may look in the mirror and we may wish we had something different about us, maybe more hair, maybe that our body would be shaped different, maybe that I was born in a different place, or maybe there's all kinds of maybes, right? All kinds of wishes that we could have. Or maybe it's about our personality or our temperament or our experiences in life or our workplaces. We were created by God the way that we are because he wanted one of us. He wanted one of you in the world. There was no mistake made. There was no second thoughts. There was no, maybe if I could do it again, I would make them this way. No, before the creation of the world, he chose you. He wanted one of you in his world. Now, with that understanding, Paul goes on to then remind us that who Christ is and what Jesus did for us was all part of God's plan so that we could be with him forever and for eternity. He says that all things were appointed to Christ and under Christ and in Christ and through Christ. That he was given the full authority of the Godhead because he was God in the flesh who came to the world to redeem us, to buy us back. Because remember, he chose us. He wants you. And so he made a way in the sinful world, in the broken world that we live in, that we can be accepted back into the perfect relationship with a perfect Father once again, with God in heaven. That all things were done through Christ, and that he is the head of the church, and that he was God's hand at work in the world at that time and still is today. All things were made alive in Christ, we read in chapter 2. Paul reminds us that at once we were separate from God, we were dead, is what Paul says. We were dead in our sins and our transgressions, but yet we can be made alive through the forgiveness that we find through Christ because of him. And it's not just talking about an eternity that we will spend with our Heavenly Father. He's talking about right now in the world that we live in, with all the brokenness that we experience, that we are being made alive, that we are in a place where he is with us and has changed us and is changing us, creating us as his masterpiece in the world that we live in. We are alive for all eternity, Scripture tells us, but we also live in that reality, in that kingdom of God, in his nation, in his world, in his kingdom right now, today and tomorrow. And the day after, we live in that reality. The reality that Christ died for us, that he has moved us from death to life as well, and that he is shaping us into who God created us to be before the fall, before sin entered the world, before the mistakes that we've made and the things that have been done to us. He molds us, he shapes us, he changes us. If you remember the one video from the one week, he chisels away the things in our life that need to be chiseled away so that he can create the masterpiece that he knows that we are, so that we can become like him, like how he created us to be, more like Christ. And then Paul goes on in chapter 4 and 5 to remind us of some of the ways that this understanding should shape and change our lives. He goes into kind of nitty-gritty details of how it shapes who we are as individuals and the decisions that we should make and the things that we should be involved in and how we act as individuals called by God, but also as a church called by God. It talks about how we clothe ourselves with God's, with His knowledge, with how we look and act in the world, how we act as husband and wife, how we act as parents or leaders or workers, employees, employers, managers, how we live as neighbors to those around us. All of this shaped by the realization that God loves us so deeply that He did all of this for us, right? And because of that, it should shape how we act and what we do, a realization that God loves us so much that He is molding us into these into who He sees us to be as His individuals, as His people, as His son or daughter. Now we remember, but because there is a God who loved us so much that His son died for us, that realization should change us. But it doesn't end there, right? It doesn't end just with His death. It begins with His resurrection. It changes who we are. That He conquered death, and through death now lives, through that death and resurrection now lives with us. He's empowering us by the Holy Spirit for work today and in the days ahead. And now in these final verses, in the final stage of this masterpiece in progress of the book of Ephesians, Paul tells us that we need to be ready to live this way in the world around us right now. He tells us that we need to remain strong in the world that we live in because of what Christ has done for us, because of who God is and what that means to us, and because of this reality that we have moved from death to life, that we have moved from sin to salvation, that we have been shaped into more of who God wants us to be. Paul is keenly aware of the realities of what it means to follow Christ. He writes this letter from being in prison because of his faith and because he was sharing this good news message with others. He is keenly aware that just because we follow Christ doesn't mean that our life is simple, doesn't mean that we don't struggle, that it doesn't mean that there isn't a one attacking us, trying to draw us away from God. He's keenly aware that some of us have had extremely difficult lives, where we have been hurt by ones we love, hurt by ones we didn't know, hurt by ones that we will never be able to confront. In this reality, we need to remain strong and stand firm. Because that doesn't change God's love for us. That doesn't change His acceptance of us. And it doesn't change the fact that He will still die for us. All of these things still remain true, even though we live in the midst of a difficult, difficult world. I want to read to you Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. And many of you will remember this passage. It's one that we often talk about. In fact, my kids used to have costumes that they would dress up in that looked exactly like this armor of God that we're going to read about. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10, Paul writes, he says, "Finally, after everything that has come before, finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly, as I should. Paul begins by saying, finally, be strong, remain strong. Four times in here, he uses the command to stand firm. What we miss a little bit in the English language is in that first verse, in verse 10, where he says, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. In the Greek language, there's actually different tenses, right? And this one is used in a passive tense, which means that when we be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power, this actually isn't our own power. It's something that's done for us or on behalf of us. It's God's power working in us that helps us to remain strong. It's God's power working in us that helps us to remain strong. Everything that follows is based on a decision we make to allow God to be at work in our lives. It's not that we need to do this on our own. It's not that we can even attempt to do this on our own. It's that God is already at work in the lives of his followers to help them not only become a masterpiece, but to remain strong, to be able to stand firm. And we're going to see that as we look at the different elements of the armor of God that are there. But it's not passive. It's not done on our own strength. It's done in him and through him in our lives. It's done to us through God, not by us, that we have to come up with our own strength to stand firm. Now, this is not a quick fix, but it's a life that we live where we draw strength from Christ and more strength as we draw closer to Christ, right? As we draw closer to him, we begin to experience more and more of him in our life, and this power and this strength helps us even more and more. Be strong in the Lord, and in his mighty power, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. So that you can take your stand. Earlier, if you look through Ephesians and read through it again, you can notice that he talks about sitting with Christ, and then he talks about walking with Christ, and now he's talking here about standing with Christ. Taking a stand, making a statement, remaining firm in your convictions and in your place because of what Jesus has done for you. Be ready, he says. Put on this armor of God so that you can stand against the devil's schemes. He then goes into a very interesting passage of scripture that some in the church have made a big deal of, understanding or looking at the different ways that the spiritual world around us works. And this is one of the passages that they turn to and derive a lot of meaning from. And we're going to talk about it here really briefly. And then I want to kind of summarize some of my thoughts. But he says, take a stand against the devil's schemes. Now, that part I'm keenly aware of. The devil is known as a schemer, a liar. He is a trickster, trying to draw us away from Christ and pull us away from him. It's a real spiritual being that is trying to draw us away from Christ. And often it's done through his tricking of us in some way. Sometimes when I talk with people, it's the little things, just enough good and biblical things mixed with enough that is ungodly to make you think, oh, it's not really that big of a deal. And the devil, one step at a time, begins to trick you and draw you away from Christ. It's small things mixed with good things, small bad things mixed with good things. It can be changes in culture, changes in the world around us. Ways where he doesn't want us to fully realize how much Christ has meant to us, One of the things that I talk with people about often when we meet one-on-one is the idea that sins of their past have weighed them down so much that they don't know how they can move on. When God has forgiven you, He's forgiven you of those sins. One of the things that I believe the devil does is to continually remind us that we'll never be good enough because of what we did in the past. And that's not God's view. That's not a scriptural view. Yes, we need to seek forgiveness for those things. And yes, sometimes they impact our lives and our future on this plane and this world. But God's forgiven them. He doesn't need to bring them back. Satan will to cut you down and to draw you away. Paul then goes into talking about our battles being spiritual against rulers, authorities, powers, and spiritual forces. These really are ungodly leaders, governing authorities, worldly influences, and spiritual forces that are opposite from God. In reality, we live in one world in which there is both a physical and a spiritual world that we live in. Both are elements of who we are and what we live within. And there are both godly and ungodly forces within this world. Now, I try to take my cues from Scripture, and I learn and I grow as well, just like everyone else. But I believe that evil and the discussion of Satan or the devil is not a focus of Scripture. He's definitely mentioned enough that I believe that he's real from what I read and what I've experienced. It's real and evident. It's true. But it's not something that we need to focus on. And in fact, the disciples weren't even worried about the devil or his schemes or what was true. What they are more concerned with is the 100-some verses that come before us about us realizing how much God loves us. And when we understand that, it draws us close to God and away from the spiritual world. Here in just a few short verses, he reminds us that there is a world out there, there is a spiritual realm that is trying to pry us away from who God is. But it's not the priority for him. In fact, this is one of the longer passages of Scripture that talks about the spiritual world around us. It gets a very short amount of play within Scripture, and I think that's for a reason. I think the reason is that it shouldn't be the focus of our lives either. God is the only God, and He is the powerful one, the all-powerful one. And what Jesus has done for us has already conquered sin and death. And when we live in that reality, these other things, though we may experience them, do not have power or control over us because of Spirit that lives within us. We could talk for hours, we could talk for days, but I want to leave it at that for now. That the spiritual world is real and active, and Paul is reminding us here that we need to be aware of it and we need to stand firm against it, but we don't need to be scared of it. We don't need to spend time really apart from what we see in Scripture, worrying about it, because Christ has already conquered this spiritual realm. And when Christ lives in us, He empowers us. Remember, it's His power that empowers us. He then goes into a description of the armor of God. And this is really using the military image of the time of what a soldier would wear as they gathered together. And he's saying these are the things that you need to put on to protect yourself from the attacks of the enemies that are enemy that is out there. And it's an illustration that he uses. I've heard some people who will say, you know, I get up every morning and I put on the helmet of salvation and the belt of truth, and they go through the motions. And that may be a helpful illustration for you. But that's not exactly what Paul was meaning here. He's using this illustration, which is actually he borrowed from Isaiah in the Old Testament, uses the same illustration of the armor used, and it's also used in negative ways in Scripture as well. when God is going out against people, that these are the spiritual battle that's happening. The imagery of armor is used there as well. But here he reminds us of how we stand firm and the things that we can do as God's power works in us and through us. There's a belt of truth that we wear, a breastplate of righteousness. He says, feet fitted with the readiness of the gospel of peace, a shield of faith, a helmet of salvation, a sword of the Spirit. And he says, in all of this, you need to continue to pray. When we live these things out in that same order, we simply, when we put on that belt of truth, we wrap God's truth around us. We let it support us and protect us. When we stand firm in what we believe in Scripture, it empowers us. So if we think specifically about just the book of Ephesians, next time you look in the mirror and you wonder, I only wish I was like this. Next time someone approaches you at work or in a grocery store and they hit you with their cart as they walk by, and that little bit of you goes, and you wonder if you should, do something back. And then you think, no. I can be nice. I can be a person of peace. Not a big deal. And then you begin to think, maybe I wish I wasn't like that. Maybe I wish God could have made me a little different. The truth of Scripture says that God loves you, that He made you, that He wants you to be with Him in heaven. Yes, there's sin in the world. Yes, it has shaped us, but He's working at reshaping us, at molding us into who He designed us to be. And when we put on that belt of truth that God died for us, that He died for me in just the way I am, it allows you to look back in that mirror, to look back in your own heart, to look back at what people have said about you and say, I'm going to stand on what God believes, not on what my heart is saying, not on what they're saying. I'm loved. I'm loved so much that the Creator of the world died for me so that He could be with me. I'm going to trust that truth more than my own feelings. That's the belt of truth. That's what Paul is talking about. He's not talking about an image that will protect us in a spiritual or a physical battle. He's talking about the spiritual battle that goes on in our hearts and minds and in the world around us. In the same way, when we put on the breastplate of righteousness, it's about letting right living or righteousness, right living, protect us. In Ephesians, as Paul talked about how we should live in the world in our relationships with our spouses and kids, with our family, with our neighbors, how we should live lives not marked by sin, but marked by the holiness of God, that we should allow God to shape us and change us. That right living protects us because it changes who we are. It protects our heart and our life in new ways. When we fit our feet with the readiness of the gospel of peace, it helps us to realize that we have a place and a position in this kingdom to help share, to be ready to move and grow. It doesn't mean that we all become evangelists standing on the street corners on a soapbox. It does mean that we all experience God in a way that we can be ready to share this gospel, this good news story with someone else. Or maybe the shield of faith that protects us from those flaming arrows, the schemes of the evil one. Literally, in those days, the picture would be a frame of a shield with a leather stretched over top that when they would go into battle, they would soak in water so that as flaming arrows were shot at them, the arrows would be put out by the wet leather and protect them. And that image is used here to help us understand the spiritual battles and the spiritual way that this shield protects us from the evil one around us, from these schemes and acts, these little jabs that get thrown our way, trying to pull us away from God. And a helmet of salvation, reminding us that as God has saved us, He has changed who we are. He has saved us. In our hearts and our minds, we are now alive instead of dead. We are part of His kingdom instead of on our own. And the sword of the Spirit is the active, living work of the Spirit in our lives, helping us, working in us, and also working through us. It's not just the Scripture, which is an important part, but it's the active Spirit in us that Paul is referring to here. That God is alive and active in us and works through us. He then goes on to say, in all of this, pray. In all locations, with all kinds of prayers and requests. Prayer needs to be key and central to who we are because it's our communication, our way that we talk with God, and also the way that we hear from Him. Pray not just for yourself, but pray for all of the Lord's people. See, right living does not just happen. Right? Living the way God wants us to live in the world doesn't just happen. Yes, He empowers us. Yes, He protects us. Yes, He works in us. But we need to be active in this whole scenario as well. It's a battle, Paul says. Opposition is certain, and help is available to us. And prayer is essential in this. But we need to be ready. We need to put on that belt, put on that helmet, put on the righteousness of God. We need to act and learn and love and live the way that we know we should once we've encountered Christ. The opposition is certain. And Paul reminds us of that here. After all of the things that He has shared with us about who Christ is and what He's done for us and who we are in that mind, He's saying, just remember that life is going to be hard and you need to be ready to stand firm in the midst of all of this. He says, you are loved, you've been chosen, you've been bought from this world by the sacrifice of Jesus, by God in the flesh. You have been shaped and are being shaped into the image of the God who created you. And as you make choices to follow Him, it shapes you, it molds you. Now He wants you. He has given His Spirit to you. He has given His Spirit to us to help us, to strengthen us, to surround us and protect us. As we trust and as we believe and as we accept His help, we have the power and the ability to stand firm in the battle, which really is a battle for our own souls, right? That's what this armor protects, is it protects us. It protects who we are as we stand in these truths. I think there's some things I want you to notice in the songs that we're going to sing in just a moment. As we worship God through song, these themes are going to come up again and again as we stand firm or true, as we stand in the presence of our enemies, but yet have a strength that's unknown to us, but is God working through us. I want you to think about these words, and as you sing them, I want you to declare them today. This will be your act of putting on the armor of God today. And then we get to finish it by putting on or practicing the gift of prayer after that. I want to invite the worship team to come up, and they're going to lead us in a last set of songs here. But just think about these words as we sing them together, as they lead us in this way.
Hopeless at times, that you can cling to scripture and put on that armor. So as we lead this next melody, just join us in singing, or maybe you just want to listen this morning, sit or stand, however you feel led. Close your eyes or just listen, and join us when you're ready.
Hallelujah.
for the spirit of heaviness, put on the garment of praise. That's how we fight our battles. This is how I fight my battles.
a message that very much touched my heart and for a lot of everybody else's. I'd like to kind of set down my mic and have you guys join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, that is a prayer that has always been on my heart every time I've been in times of trouble, when I've been in times of joy. It is a prayer that Jesus has given to us directly. So I encourage you guys, as we go on tour this week, to keep that on your hearts. Keep Pastor Curtis's message on your hearts and just wear the armor of God proudly and to share his love. And with that, I send you off. Currently, we are going to go towards the Zoom prayer. So, if you guys are online, please go to the Zoom link sent to you guys in your guys' weekly email. And us as a congregation here in house will take a moment of silence to while we wait for that.